subtle things they didn't tell you. If you didn't write it down, it never happened. Document everything. I nailed this math professor years and years ago. Write down a solution, no steps, you don't get any points. I don't care if you're right or not, right? Same thing with the bugs. You say you tested all this stuff. If you didn't show me in test link that you recorded that you did it or the bug didn't, I have no, it didn't work, okay? Version your software. Make sure every build version is unique. I don't know how many times I have to come after people like that. People, like, what they do is they forget to increment the number, or, you know, granted systems are much better now, but the idea is that if I cannot 100% recreate that environment, I don't even want to kind of talk to you, because what happens is I don't know the difference, right? Did you release, people will just go always, oh, did you test this version, that version, this iteration or whatever. The idea is version all your software. I don't care what it is, because as a tester, the very first thing I do is when I reproduce a bug, I look at what version it is. Because I don't want you to come back to me and say later, oh, we fixed it already, right? If there's not enough time for testing, it usually means the policy is shipping anyways, right? So people say, oh, there's not enough time to do testing. Oh, well, it's not in time. Too bad. Like, testing does, it's like baking. It doesn't go faster, like, just because you want it to, right? Usually that's a good sign you got problems here if there's not enough time for testing. A couple tips and tricks. So these are ones that are very practical. There's six of them that I've actually taken from one of the test books I have listed down here. First one, when a rut, take 5 minutes break. Fresh eyes, fine, fresh failure. This is Cam, he wrote a book, like something like 52 reasons, or what's the book called? The book is called Lessons Learned in Software Testing, okay? So the idea here is, it's really strange how this sort of works, but the idea is sometimes you just really need to uncouple yourself, and it sounds super trivial, but like even just like developers take a little break. Sometimes you need to take a little break and come back, and all your brain kind of, your subconscious, I don't know how that works, but you know, you'd be surprised how fresh eyes find failure, okay? Number two, work out incomplete test cases before attempting to run this one. I've seen this a lot of problems. People come up with this huge, the test lead comes in and they want to justify, I don't say justify this, it sounds really bad. They're really gung-ho, and they come in and they create a whole bunch of, they try to do as much coverage as much as, because they believe that as many test cases as they write is will determine how much coverage they have. Unfortunately, they don't do a good job. If I were to give any advice to writing test case, I would rather have quality over quantity. I'd rather have completeness over volume. Okay, what that means is, because what happens is incomplete, by very nature, is like lacking to, failing to plan is planning to fail. What happens is you have an incomplete test case, which will give incomplete knowledge to the tester, which will give incomplete knowledge to the coder, which basically trickles all the way down. Fix your test cases up front, right? Much like you want the coders to have good code, you gotta have good test cases. Don't take the easy way out. Simple conditions and test data are often used by unit testers. Most errors rely on more complicated cases. It's at this point now, everybody kind of using unit testing and iterative models. Most of the simple cases are sort of usually tested out that way. You manually redoing an automated unit test is, unless you feel like you need to test the unit test, it's not very useful. Do you get what I'm saying? So sometimes we've run into this where guys have created this huge abstract thing and they end up testing the tool versus, like, happens in localization, right? They almost like test so much where they're basically testing how the tool works. But coming back to this point, don't take the easy way out. Go find the tough stuff that people haven't done. Make every case count. You gotta kinda have this kind of thinking going in. You kinda look at them as there's some type of resource. Like, these are the last crackers in the world, right? Like, what am I gonna get you use for them? These are like money out of your wallet. You're only gonna be able to do so many. So don't waste time on redundant cases, okay? Because you will run out of time. You always run out of time. Five, dig deeper, know the limits, extent of failure. Systems are often intertwined, right? So spend time figuring out root issues and test cases. What this means is you'll get much more respect from your coders if you get good at doing this. You help them debug systems. So when you go and you hit something, they will have more respect for you. When you go in and you hit something and you start testing around, you figure out what's the, you help them debug the situation because they know that you're on their side. You're helping them out. If you go and just say, hey, hands off, I found a bug. Okay, check it in. Check, that's the bug. There you go. You're not really helping the system because the idea, the goal was getting stuff fixed, remember? Right? So dig deep. Put your effort in because you want them to put their effort in on the other side, right? And then sixth one, attack weak areas. Those famous items, you know, where there's smoke, there's fire, right? The idea is like, it was initially here before the bad the Bad Neighbor tour and stuff like that. But the idea is, usually that's what happens. You go, I don't know how many times I've gone to, you know, if you look at the tracking of bugs, you'll go in and then you'll find some and then bam, because they're all kind of like the way it is. Like Meyer will tell you that. That's usually the way it comes. You come, where there's one, there's like hundreds. Like, it's literally like bugs. You turn over a rock and there's like, there's one ant that you will follow down the trail and then you find this whole farm, right? It's usually the way they come up. Wayne's matrix of software quality. Okay, so the end of the day, after all talking about all those things, say you're a tester, this is the conversation I usually have with anybody I want to help, that wants me to help with their system. And there are many people who bang down my door and I say, I kind of sit them down and I have this little preparatory talk with them. But I say, this is the matrix of the world. Okay, basically this axis is number of bugs, this is testability. What I say is, all products fall in one of these four quadrants. The first quadrant is, there's bugs and it's not testable. It's not testable, I'm not even gonna start. I don't get involved, because these are impossible. Because they're impossible to test, they're impossible to find new bugs, you just won't get anywhere, okay? The opposite side is, this is the dream, where things are testable and bugs, but there's no bugs, but it's testable. That's great. So all you do is you run your TestLink cases in your Dredger suite and they're all good. This is the dream world. Usually, you're in these two kind of realms. Don't get convinced that this is a good realm. The no bugs, not testable. I've made this mistake myself. Go into code that's fairly good, but not testable means that, yes, this round of testing is gonna be very good. When the next coder goes in, he's not as good, or scope change and stuff like that, it's only a temporary placebo. It's only good for now. You need code that's testable. I always tell testers that. This is a much bigger topic. This is actually a coding standards type of topic. This idea, you want to build things for like, build for those problems, right? So what happens is, I want stack traces, I want dumps, I want internal logging, I want thresholding logging that I can increase up and stuff like that, right? Because in the end of the day is, you want me to help that bug? If those tools aren't there, I just can't get into the code to help you out. I can't help you do anything. Because I've had products like that where the app just randomly cuts out. Well, sure, that's great. There's no debugging code, no nothing, no stack trace, no nothing. I'm just gonna create 400 bugs that say app crashed. That's the discussion sometimes that you have to have if you're not the person building the system, is, yeah, sure, it might not have any bugs in shippable, but it's only gonna be temporary. Reality, what we're usually in this quadrant, which is the doable one, where I say, yes, I'll help. Wayne, as Wayne, I will come and help you. His idea is, you have some bugs, I'll help you. I don't mind, right? But the idea is it's testable. Really, that testable means helping like debug, you know, stack traces, that kind of. I don't need bug-free code, I just need testable. What I say, the conversation usually starts like this. You can ship kind of two codes. Code that's bug-free, and I can help you with code that's testable. Those other quadrants, I don't really like them too much, right? But the idea is, I just want to kind of put that up to you, because if you kind of sign up for something like this, just be wary that none of these tools that I've showed you today will kind of really help you, right? These are non-testing sort of tools that affect quality. Remember we talked about getting stuff fixed? So they don't necessarily always fall under the umbrella of testing, but they're very important. Pair programming. So some statistics say, you know, if you're, do you do pair programming? Yeah, so pair programming, the statistic is right now, I don't know how they come up with this, but they say about 70% less bugs. Okay. Logging, debugging features. This is that one we talked about, that previous matrix. Test-driven development. So you can kind of get yourself ahead of the game if you can convince your developers to start using test-driven development in the first place. Because you know what? They end up writing the unit tests for you. They get all kind of stuff done for you. So, good requirements, acceptance criteria. You'd be surprised how much of bugs are really not really bugs. Like, they're actually implemented properly. It's the problem of the requirements is different. Peer review, design review, those are important. Last one, I don't know if you guys use it, SAP heavily uses it. Small companies, I'm not so sure like that this is applicable for you, but there are code checkers that will do some stuff for you. We're talking about the possibility. Sonar is one, Fortify. We have a bunch that we run at SAP before you can go through our pill process. But that's another option for you. So we're not talking testing, these are just review, automatic code review. Books, all great books. Some of them are older, some of them are newer, but I'll let you kind of read them out. So with that, I think we're done.